Okay, so thank you, Antonio, for hosting this session again.
And yes.
I think it's a great way of shooting some very preliminary ideas into the audience and hopefully make full papers out of them later. This is indeed two late-breaking abstracts combined into one, because we don't know which direction we're going yet. So we'll leave that up to you. And also thank you, Antonio, for answering the email at 3 o'clock this morning. That shows real scientific dedication, I think.
Yes, you're welcome.
And okay, so let's go. This talk is about the plant propagation algorithm. And the plant propagation algorithm is actually a population-based algorithm. So you have a population of, say, 30 individuals, just calling a number. And what it does, basically, is for these individuals, first, it normalizes all the objective values between 0 and 1. So the highest has 1 and the lowest has 0. And now there is a tricky little step between assigning the objective values and assigning the fitnesses. There's a little step in between. You don't have to do it, but the algorithm is designed like that by these two gentlemen, Eric Fraga and Abdel Salhi. And it has no crossover, so it's different from a regular genetic algorithm. But what it does, basically, is the top of the population produces a lot of offspring. So the offspring is fitness proportional. But the mutation of that offspring is inversely fitness proportional. So the top of the population produces many offspring with small mutations or tiny mutations, and the bottom of the population produces few offspring with a lot of mutations. And then all of these offspring are slushed back into the population, and the 30 fittest individuals of those get selected for the next generation. So it's elitist die out, if you like. And now I have a little animation. It's very advanced, you will see soon. And it's about a picture approximation task. So the closer the polygon constellation is to the original picture, the better it is. So this is the best individual in the population. This is worse. This is even worse. This is the worst individual of this population of four. And the first one produces a lot of offspring with tiny mutations. The second one, slightly less, with bigger mutations, most of them worse. Third one, still fewer offspring, bigger mutations. And the last one only produces one offspring. Well, it disappears behind my screen here. Can you see it? It's a little heap of shards right here at the right-hand side.
Yeah. Yes, we can see.
So the whole idea
very
is...
ugly. A very ugly image.
Yes, it's a very ugly image indeed. And then what happens is it takes the four best individuals of the whole thing and it deletes the rest. I made this myself. How about that, huh? So for this investigation, we used the famous benchmark test functions. And you might ask why these benchmark test functions. And the reason is that all the publications on plant propagation and fireworks algorithm from China use some of these benchmark test functions. So this is a union of them. And therefore, we can hopefully compare results. So now an individual is a point in space, and the mutation size is the distance it travels throughout the domain. Now, these are two-dimensional benchmark functions, and these are n-dimensional benchmark functions. You can make them in two dimensions, in 30 dimensions, in 91 dimensions, and 273 dimensions if you like, but we can only make pictures of the 2D benchmark functions. And the reason why we take both of these is because a previous study has shown that the algorithm performs differently on the different classes of functions. And we don't know why, and we don't know how that works, but this is why we got this set of benchmark functions. Okay. So as I told you before, the fittest individuals produce offspring, many offspring proportional to the fitness value. And the mutation is inversely proportional to the fitness value, right? But now the thing is that these are the normalized objective functions. So as I said earlier, the objective functions get normalized from 1 to 0 throughout the population. And then the fitness assignment is a little bit different because from the objective function, we make the fitness by using this tangent function, tangent hyperbolicus, I think it's called in English. And that smoothens out the objective functions a bit to the fitness values. So I asked the original inventors why they did this, and they had a whole lot of, they gave me a whole lot of reasons. Many of them are just probably made up on the spot, but the fact is that it's in there. And if you look at that function, the fitness function, from the objective values to the fiction, oh, hey, what's that? All right. Yes. So here's the objective values normalized between 0 and 1. Here's the fitness values. It smoothens out a little bit. The consequence of using this hyperbolical tangent is that the least fit is no longer the least fit individual, no longer has a fitness of 0. And the most fit individual does not have a fitness of 1 anymore. And now, Wouter, he's my first author. Wouter's idea was because the fitness is not 1, the mutation step is also not very, very tiny. And to reach absolute optimality, you must be able to make tiny mutation steps into the peak of the benchmark test function. Come on. So this is his sheet. It's called the strawberry algorithm, so boxing strawberry. So he did a little preliminary test. And what he did was he took this hyperbolical tangent that maps the objective values to the fitness. And he just changed that constant. And he also changed this constant, so it's still between 0 and 1. And the preliminary results were really, really funnily, as the reached minimum was much better for higher values, but it went there slower. Because as you can see, this one goes faster, goes down faster, and this one goes down slower. And again, it's not very thoroughly investigated yet. It's still quite new. But what he did was, his idea was, let's change this fitness function. Let's change the steepening of the fitness function while we are running and trying to get the best of both worlds. So the fitness function starts off like this and becomes this throughout the runs. Yes, and you can steepen it really quickly or you can steepen it slowly, 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 slowly. And this is what we did. We tried various degrees, various speeds of steepening for this investigation. Right? And the first results were really, really stunning. This is a very easy function. This is the sphere benchmark function. And the default plant propagation algorithm moves like this, and it reaches a good value. I mean, 10 to the power minus 2 or something, 10 to the power minus 3. The global minimum is at 0. So it performed quite well. But then with the adaptive function, the steepening fitness function, the thing just exponentially, this is a logarithmic scale, exponentially dropped down to below 10 to the minus 26 and reached the absolute 0 point of the benchmark test function considering that your computer has a certain resolution. Okay, so we've seen these before. These are 2D functions that we used, and we have the ND functions that we used, and now we have some results on this. So here are some results on the 2D benchmark test functions. And what you see on the horizontal axis is the slowness of the steepening process of the fitness function, right? So right here, the fitness function really goes really fast from this to that. And here at the end, it goes really, really slowly throughout the iteration from this to that. And now the darker a cell is, the lower the end value. And black means 10 to the power, here we go, 10 to the power minus 35, which is largely equivalent to the absolute zero of the benchmark test function. And so we see roughly this window. Each window is, I think, is 5 runs, the median of 5 runs, so the end value of 5 runs. And we see these windows, these kind of black holes, in which the plant propagation function just dashes all the way down to the absolute zero point of the benchmark test function. And it's really, really sharp at the edges here. See? And the patterns are slightly different. So this one has a very wide black hole in which it goes to the zero point. This one has a narrower black hole, a wide black hole, a wide black hole. And then here in between, and this is what I meant earlier, that the algorithm tends to behave a little different on different benchmark test functions. All of a sudden, there's no sudden black hole, but more like a sloping slide down to the absolute zero hell or something like that. But it's more like a slide. It's not like a steep black hole from here. So here, the algorithm is behaving normally. And here, all of a sudden, bang, down to the absolute zero. And here we see a different pattern. So we also have a slide here, which is in the sphere function, in which it performs really, really well. But for many functions, for n dimensions, we don't see this black hole. And these are n dimensional, but we used only the two-dimensional variant. But here you can typically see that these that this algorithm behaves very differently on different functions. And we have not been able to allocate the properties of this function, of these benchmark test functions, that actually are responsible for these differences, right? Though two of these ND benchmark functions, they also show kind of a dotted black hole. What we expect, but we're not really sure, is if we increase the number of runs from 5 to 10, that these little islands of malperformance will also disappear, right? So the steepening of the fitness function has a great, great effect on some benchmark functions, a really, really good improvement, while for others, like the cigar, which is definitely worse, it has no effect, right? So things can only get better. The computational overhead is almost zero, so it doesn't cost anymore. And well, these are the preliminary results I have to show you today. And then there's one more thing, because Antonio mailed me this morning at 3 o'clock, but that was only because I finished my poster at 2:30. And since I can probably not show it anymore, I have just put it in at the last slide. Are you ready for some awesomeness? There we go. So here's all the results summarized. And well, I think it's a particularly nice effect to see all this in one view. Okay, I'll give the word to Antonio. Thank you very much for your attention, and I'll be ready to take some questions if you have any.
Okay, thank you very much, Dan. I have to say that well, the posters should be uploaded by the 13th of March. So you are a bit late.
I know. Yeah.
So that's the problem. But anyway, I have asked Anna if it's possible to include your poster. I guess no. She said right now that we have a hole in the session, but it was covered yesterday. So I think it's not possible, unfortunately. But anyway, here is your poster. You can receive questions right now. Thanks for your presentation, Dan. I just have a question. Are you planning to apply this algorithm to real problems? Do you have any problem in mind for the near future?
Yes, a lot actually. So I'm talking to this company who is making schedules for schools in China, which are very, very big schedule. And we have had some preliminary success with university timetabling. And then there's the community of Amsterdam, and we have underground garbage containers in which we throw the garbage in and they get lifted out and dumped. But which container is where in the city is an optimization problem, because you want to minimize the walking distance. And that's 88,000 containers. And I'm also talking to them for this algorithm to use. The University of Cambridge, Pembroke College, is also trying to make a university timetabling algorithm. And I'm also trying to get them to try this or anything else, just hill climbing. But the main problem is, I find, is that we, as a bunch of scientists, have a very, very large distance towards industry in explaining what we do. So even things that are for us really simple are hard to explain to industry. So that's a slow ongoing process. I want to tell them everything in one go, but I have to take it one step at a time. But to answer your question, I think it's very valuable that we should contribute to society too. So yes, I am definitely wanting to apply this to real problems.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good. You have a couple of questions in the chat. I don't know if Bill, do you want to speak?
Yeah. So what I was thinking was, we have some very odd results, so it's difficult to get an idea on these benchmarks when the algorithm is working well and when it's not working well. And so an idea was to try to actually evolve not the solution, but to evolve the benchmark. And I was thinking perhaps you could have a case where you applied the plant algorithm versus something like CMAES and see what characteristics the evolved benchmarks have, and would those benchmarks perhaps explain why the algorithm is working well, and conversely when it does not work well.
Bill, thank you very much for your question. So I think it's about two or three questions in one, and I'll try to answer every aspect of it. So first of all, comparing to another algorithm like CMES is, or simulated annealing or whatever, is very well possible. You get a different study, but that's very well possible. Your second question as to whether it's possible to actually engineer hard benchmark functions, we have a preliminary result on that, but the original author did not want to submit it as an LBA this year. But what we did is, where is it? The 6-hump camel. Here it is. What we did is we kind of hill climbed the 6-hump camel So this is a couple of quadratics, this function over here, and it has parameters. So it's something like 4 times x1 squared minus 3 times x2 squared, etc., etc. And we tweak those parameters every 10,000 evaluations to see whether we could deteriorate the problem, the performance of the Plant propagation algorithm. And that's without the steepening function. So it's the original thing. So I'm hoping that I'm answering your question correctly. And what came out is really funny. It started to look like the ESOM function. So basically, the whole thing was elevated to a very to a very flat plateau with some very steep edges on the side. So that means that your Plant propagation algorithm, which sorts the fitness, can no longer sort anymore because all the fitnesses are equal when it's on a plateau. So that's what we have right now. And I'm actually making a project on engineering all these benchmark functions in the widest possible sense, because now we only did the parameters and we want to do everything. So before I answer the last part of your question, let me check with you on whether I answered part of your question already, Bill.
So the idea was to try to understand the algorithm rather than the more about understanding than actually improving performance. So the idea was to actually create or use evolution to create new benchmarks and hope that those benchmarks, by stressing different parts of the algorithm, would make it clear how it was working.
Yes. So that I would not instantly know how to do it. I have to think about that. So what we did now was just test the whole algorithm, kind of stress test the algorithm as a whole. But I do have another remark which might be related. I'm just trying, Bill, just correct me in retrospect, is that these benchmark functions have different components. So this one has a sine function in there. And it also has, this one here has absolute stripes and a square root. So, and it, another investigation, which is not published here, which has been published earlier, suggests that the performance of the algorithm, again, as a whole, might depend on the individual constituents of these benchmark functions. So we're trying to evolve. That's what I want to do anyways. We're trying to evolve in a broader way. So not only changing parameters, but changing entire functions. Did I answer your question? Question a little bit or elucidate somewhat?
Okay, so I was just thinking that we had an example where we used GP to evolve functions, and so the function that was being evolved was not the solution but the problem, and the goal of that study was to try and learn things about the search technique rather than actually solving the problem. So it's more and more a question of trying to get knowledge about what we're searching with, knowledge about the tools rather than actually immediately solving the problem.
Yes, that's completely what we want to do too.
Okay.
Yeah, and so the genetic, so to be a little more technical, the genetic programming aspect of it, in my view at least, is viewing these functions as a mathematical tree. So it's x squared plus the square root of the sine of x2 squared and the cosine of something else. You get this tree. You can just take chunks out and evolve them in a way, so mutate them or either cross over them. But you have to make it so general, of course, that in principle you can reach any kind of benchmark function, any kind of formula?
Yeah, but you perhaps just want a range of, I don't think it's necessary to have all possibilities, but certainly we got some interesting things from fairly simple functions. But it's the sort of thing that you try the experiment and see what comes, and hopefully it gives you an intuition about the search technique.
When you say we build, do you mean that you have done some experiments on this? Because I'd love to see your papers, Stefan.
Oh, okay. So this was published in CC 2005, I think, in Edinburgh. I can certainly send you the reference, and there's some nice animations of population search on these evolved landscapes.
Please do. I'm very much looking forward.
Okay, I will do that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you to both of you.